Welcome back, everybody, here to your coverage of the Join Dota Masters. We are here in the 13th installment of the Join Dota Masters here at the Grand Final Time. Game number two, where Na'Vi is currently going up against KP. KP looking very, very flawless throughout the whole tournament. Na'Vi looking very, very rough throughout most of the tournament until the last game, at which point it looked a hell of a lot better for them. How about look here in game number two? With a hit of a button, we jump ourselves to the wrong overlay, now the right overlay. It is inside the game, into the draft, and welcome in my co-caster for this broadcast. He is the man from Team Liquid, as well as America. He is a man that represents American Dota. It is Bulba. What's up, man?
Well, thanks. I can't wait to see if what the picks are actually going to be, because I feel both teams, they're trying to outdraft each other, specifically. I mean, it's hard to say that. I mean, outdraft each other's styles. I think there's going to be a few heroes that are going to be important for both teams. I think Bane and Mag and Clockwork are priorities for Kaipi. And Na'Vi know that. Puppy knows that. And I think he's going to try to at least take one of those heroes. Because last game, he didn't let them get Bane, Mag, and Clock. He took the Bane off. So I can't wait to see what Kaipi pick. And Na'Vi's actually first picked this game, so.
Yeah, that they are. And I'm kind of feeling like both teams are trying to bait through what I feel to be a wisp. Because right now, Lone Druid as well as Nakes both being banned out in the first set.
And with Na'Vi, there's going to be they banned Scylla, so there's Bat, Nakes, and Wisp left in the pool. Yep. So it's interesting.
There we go. Na'Vi, surprised they actually do this full on, though. They ban out the PL again against KP, but they've only got one pick. They can only take one big thing from this one. So KP now have the decision. Either they let the Wisp and the Batrider through, or they grab one of them in the next set. And we see what Na'Vi value up higher, because Mag is still available. There's a lot of different heroes available here on the pool for KP. And they will be able to pick two of these after Na'Vi has their pick. 10 seconds remaining. I got a funny feeling they're gonna take out, maybe even just ban the CK, so you don't get the CK Wisp combination. But let them come through.
Reserve time. I think they want Mag as a priority, so they might ban Mag here. I don't know. Wisp is such a strong hero too, is that you can split push endlessly with it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I think they are going to ban the Wisp. Okay, they ban the Wisp.
Okay, so Na'Vi get the Batrider or Mag. They take the Batrider.
This is really smart. They took the Bat over the Nyx because, one, they know Kaipi loved the Batrider. Bone7, he used to play Dota 1 in-house leagues, and his favorite hero every game was Batrider. He used to spam it. So I kind of remember that tidbit from a while back. But so they take the Bat. So I think Kaipi have to take the Nyx and the Mag here. I think that's the two biggest. So they're going to take Nyx and Mag here, and then Na'Vi's going to take the Bane, I feel.
How's this going to work with their lanes, though? Because, yeah, you're right. Like, Nyx and Mag get picked up. But does this now mean we see a support Nyx Assassin? Because, well, actually, it's got to be.
Yeah, it has to be.
But Mag up against its middle lane, it's not going to be like, you can't guarantee there's going to be Dendi on the Batrider. If anything, you'd probably say it'll be Funic more than anything else. And we know the Puppy has also played around with a jungle Batrider in the past. So there's three different options. It's so hard to lane up against a Batrider pick. And now Puppy can pick up the puck for, like, Mag. For Dendi, for that middle lane, or he can go down the lines of the Queen of Pain if they want to be a little bit more aggressive with their initiations.
I don't think they can take Queen of Pain. Queen of Pain gets shit on by Nyx. It's such a bad hero to go versus Nyx. Every time I see a Queen of Pain versus Nyx, it's just stupid. Because later on, it's just the damage on the mana burn makes Queen of Pain have to go for the BKB route. And it's just the damage with the mana burn is too much. I feel Na'Vi, they have to take the Bane. I think they're going to take the Bane here.
But then they might lose that Rubick. Then they might lose their Rubick. So unless they take both of them and just say, well, wait to the last point, you've got to bat out our hard carry as well as bat out our mid-solo. You'll never cover them properly.
Yeah, so you're right, actually. They have the option of the Bane or the Rubick. And Rubick is actually a really good hero versus Nyx, too. Because Rubick is one of the heroes that can actually kill the Nyx before he gets the Carapace off, because Telekinesis is instant.
Mm-hmm.
So, Rubick is probably going to be one of them, and I don't know, because Puppy knows that Kaipi is going to take Bane as a third pick. Okay, yeah, so they take the Bane. So this was kind of expected, at least in my opinion, because maybe versus another team, Na'Vi would have taken the Rubick, but they know how Kaipi plays, and they're going to take the Bane. So this is really smart from Puppy. Just like last game.
Picking up the TA, because we get our same matchup in the middle lane again, so TA up against Mag.
And I think Kaipi's going to take the clock here. If I know what I think about, if I know them well enough, they're going to take the clock here.
At which point they'll ban out the Rubick in the next set.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's hard to predict these kind of things, but it's like these teams, Kaipi picks such a limited, they take the clock too. So.
This makes it a little bit easy though for Puppy's next edge of banning. Because now we can fully focus on banning out against Eternal Envy. It might cripple him a little bit because the Force will also still be looking for a hero. But Eternal Envy is I suppose that Eternal Envy doesn't really care. Because it's still going to be Andy Mage, there's still going to be Faceless Void, there's still going to be whatever other hero he wants to run on that safe lane. He may not have the depth of like a player like Loader that you see when you look at this stage and go, well, I ban out against all the hard carries of the Alliance, and it's like, no, it's not possible.
So they ban the what Kaipi has to do is they need to ban heroes that Na'Vi can go aggressive tri-lane with.
And you actually think they're going to go aggressive tri-lane?
I feel Na'Vi's going to go aggressive tri-lane. I feel they're going to mid TA. I feel when you play mid TA, you're forced into aggressive tri-lane because this hero gets roamed a lot easily unless the TA is versus a Puck. And they want the TA to be solo versus the Mag. They don't want anyone to help the TA. I mean, they don't want anyone to help the Mag. They want the TA to just crush the Mag. And that's basically their plan. And they want the Bat Raider to safe lane and get free farm versus the Clockwork, which is a pretty bad matchup for Clockwork.
Well, I think you're right, man, because at this point I'm seeing the bans coming out, being Latrak as well as Keeper of the Light, and there's two heroes that one will synergize nicely with the Nyx, but also makes an aggressive tri lane impossible to go up against.
Yeah. They need something they can tank right now. So they might like ban the carries like Luna, etc. on Kaipi. They might ban like those agility heroes that can aggressive tri lane with and do damage.
You'd really want to run Luna in that aggressive tri lane?
No. I feel it's not a bad hero. If you have a Bane and a Luna and something else, it's really hard to go into that tri lane and kill anyone. Like, it's impossible to just fight into that Luna with the aura. Because you have the sleep, you have the sap, and then you have the Luna aura and those three ranged heroes attacking you. Mm-hmm. And it's impossible for a hero like Nyx to do anything in that.
10 seconds. Well,
so they can also ban the Darkseer, I feel.
Yes, this is taking a very, very long time to decide this. And they do ban out the Darkseer.
Na'Vi's turn to ban. So, the Darkseer...
There's some kind of like high level of hatred coming towards the Juggernaut from Puppy today. He does not like
the hero. I think
the hero
is annoying. It's annoying to play versus, definitely. Mm. It's hard to aggress a tri-lane versus Juggernaut, because he just has spin.
And there's the final ban out, so one dying. One last aggressive, and that would have been nice little tanky support hero. But Puppy's still got, like, the Lina is still clearly available for him. So if they want to go Bane, Lina plus one.
This could. I haven't seen Na'Vi pick Lina too much. It might be an option. I feel Gyro is going to be another option for Kaipi.
Mm-hmm.
It's good pairing with Clockwork and Mag. So it's good. There's really good synergy with that.
Also missing, just to point out the fact that SD is also missing from here. Yep. He hasn't been touched.
I don't feel Na'Vi's going to take SD. SD lacks damage in the tri-lane.
I'm thinking SD for KP.
Oh yeah, KP. Yeah, that's actually pretty good. It's good and defensive, and it synergizes well with Nyx.
Yep. Very, very easy to get yourself in position, as well as the Mag. Like, if you go roaming with SD, just let off that disruption, Mag walks up, and then just, you're out, Skewer, fantastic. Alchemist will be the pickup, so aggressive tri lane farmer could possibly be coming out from that one. Walks around with an AoE stun. Not a bad little thing to have if you can have both Clockwork as well as Mag both jump in engagements.
Yeah. Lina here, okay.
Yeah, there we go.
Was it Lina or Lina is good with Nyx too. And Kaipi, I think they're going to AM last pick. AM or Void.
Ooh.
Interesting.
This kind of screws our lanes up a little bit more, because if we're looking at an aggressive tri-lane now, unless we're looking at support Alchemist. But even then, it's... Yeah.
I don't even know.
It kind of feels like a defensive lane. So Batrider on the long lane. I would even put I don't know why I'm thinking this, man, but a Havorst on the Clinks. Which is funny because it's one of Funnic's signature heroes. So they could run an aggressive tri lane with a Batrider, Bane, and Alchemist on the bottom lane. 5 seconds remaining. But that'd be Puppy on the Batrider.
Oh, AM. I predicted. I think it was obviously one of the only heroes left that enemy likes playing. It was that or Void. And they need the AM to split push. Void is not going to be able to do enough damage versus the Clinks and the Alchemist. Mm-hmm. AM is like a Void, actually, in the theory that Void is kind of a team fight split pushing carry, and then AM is not a team fight split pushing carry. He's just like good at split pushing, and Void is more of like the team fight lead carry with the Chrono. So I'm really interested to see the lanes, and this is a support Alchemist. You're right.
Damn. Yeah, it is. I'm not seeing hero source too, because I was looking for that one to see if they were going to do it, but not in this scenario. But look at Funnic's items. He starts off with the Wraithband, and like it gives you flashbacks to the old like Morph Link Star build, but he's been pulled. Tangos, salves, as much life as they can give him. The Vorst also with a large amount of life, and they're running all five heroes down south. Yeah. Dendi will be as the solo mid TA, as you can see, he's already built for the vast bottle. Kuro supporting Bay on the bottom lane, and then yeah, Puppy, who's quite raw, but he's also walking around with a smoke at the very, very start. They already want to look for an opening and try and find a kill. And Zizu and Pylai dive the two supports for KP, who have failed to actually put their profile up, so well done to them. They'll be supporting Eternal Envy here on the bottom lane. No one's really going to get caught out here.
Yeah.
And then Arise in the middle lane. He really played a fantastic Magnus. And then Bone 7, whose clockwork has been impeccable tonight.
Yep. That matchup is hard, though. Clockwork. Especially since Clinks got pulled so much, he's going to have a rough time versus the Clinks.
It's kind of funny that this is the draft that Puppy or Envy. Is he going to get Blink? There's a stun from Puppy, and Kuro's Nightmare would help set up for it, but holding Envy in position at the right time for the throw, rather difficult. I don't know if it's been intentionally done, but this is the way Funnic used to play on Team Empire. And it comes on the day that Team Empire has basically had their roster ravaged. Where they lose two real big players. Like, Godblack not being a part of Team Empire anymore just for me doesn't make life make much sense at the moment. But this is Funnic's position. This is what he loves to do. Safe lane, Clinks, and he'll rotate out about maybe 13 minutes out with an Orchid.
Yep. And this is such an interesting... I've never seen a tri-lane Batrider like this. I really haven't.
Especially with Havorst playing it.
Yeah. And it's interesting because their goal right now is to limit and turn with Envy's farm and let Funnic decimate this clockwork up top.
Yeah.
Which he is going to do. There's no stance. Look at Bone 7, he's already half HP. There's nothing he can do.
He's even trying to get close enough to get some last hits, but every time he does, Funnic just harasses him back. Dendi and Arise, and even fighting back past the tier 1 tower here. Dendi's already used all of his refraction charges, but he's got his bottle up and now and running. And Arise trying to be really aggressive. You see, he's trying to rush his bottle too. He's getting very little to no farm here. Like, he's 1-for-1 up against a 6-for-7 in the middle lane, and already rotation. Kuro and Poppy are coming towards the middle lane. He's got no skewer. Magwen in power and shockwave is the first ones, and Poppy channeling almost the full stun, throws it out, and this will be first blood in the middle lane. Meld hit and then a follow-up hit. Bane will actually take the first blood. So it goes the way of Kuro, and then in the meantime, Batrider on the bottom lane. KP trying to make the most of it, realizing the supports have rotated off the bottom lane, but then Firefly and Avorts gets away to safety.
Yeah.
You were talking about out drafting during the start of this game. It kind of really feels like Na'Vi's lanes are working perfectly for them.
Yeah. That movement there was awesome. I don't think I expected that at all. And that's going to make Dendi win his lane even more. And he got a haste rune. So.
And there's still no skewer up on Mag. He went 2-point shockwave after this. So he's still got no escape mechanism. And Dendi, meld hit, refraction charges. He's not seeing a skewer just yet.
Oh my god. Denied. The clockwork is in such rough. If you look at his items, he's out of regen.
Yep. He's just used his last tango and Funnic just threw him another one. But Funnic also, he's out of mana. Like, he bought boots instead of... I was wondering about that, like, if he would buy boots or not. or if he would just go and say, well, I'll just pick up my two Sages Masks now. Like, he picks up one right now. But this is normal thing. Like, he'll just max out his Sages Masks to get the, like, obviously the two of them. And then just boost up his intelligence, boost up his regen, so we can stay on this lane, never has to move back out again.
If Clockwork is a hero in the laning phase, Clockwork is good versus heroes that you use your cogs and they're out of mana. But Klinks, he has no mana at all for, like, it takes barely any mana for Singer Wars. And look at Tom, they're actually going to roam behind the Klinks.
Yeah.
Bone 7 has no wards, he's dead.
Yeah, he's out too far, no escape mechanism, cogs won't really help him out much either. Because they'll just wait him out, they'll throw a Nightmare, or they'll just throw the stun. It'll be very, very easy. But also, Horvost. Again, they did this. They did this last time. I'm kind of forced to during their semi-final today. But Horvost, given a lot of space just to be by himself down here on the bottom lane. Maybe not the safest lane to be in, but he's playing a long lane hero now as the Batrider. And Bone 7 hides in the tree line. There goes the cogs. Funix just sees him and just, well, okay. Three attacks with Searing Arrows at level 3. Kuro as well as Puppy weren't even needed for that one. They didn't cast a single ability. And did Puppy just waste a salve? I think he just did. I clicked on him for a moment and I saw this little green effect around him. I think he just popped his salve by accident.
Yep. This is going to be a chance for Kaipi. They lost their mid lane and top lane by a huge margin. And even though AM is getting free farm, Havosa is actually getting more than what Bone 7 is getting in the solo lane. So even though Havos right now is risk 3 heroes, he's getting more than Bone 7 by far. That's basically because the threat of the aggressive tri-lane at the beginning made Kaipi's supports leave Havos solo in the lane.
Mm-hmm.
But he's getting fine, and he's going to get this entire creep wave. He's going to be level 5, near level 5.
And I'm also wondering too, like, when is it possible for KP to try and turn this one around? Like, where does it even come from? Nyx at level 6? Do we then look for his initiation? But there's no combo like we saw earlier tonight with like the Nakes Bomb to come out from that. But there's no, there's like straight in jump in, I'm sure this will work. Even Arise here in the middle lane, because he's been shut down so much in the mid, like he's running bottle, his boost just arrived too. I mentioned that Tango, now he does have his bottle. But that's 5 minutes in, and like we've been seeing Arcane Boots come up like 8 minutes up on mags, even it may be sometimes even earlier than that. But just feeling when he's gonna try and get into that Blink Dagger. Kuro and Alchemist have already rotated back into the middle lane. Arise is just bottling, and now Nightmare set up, and Puppy chains up the stun. TA with the trap as well to slow it down, and there's the stun. Meld hit, attack, nice skewer back in again on Puppy with the shockwave too. Puppy, that extra slow is not helping him out here. Kuro trying to take the damage from the tower, and Puppy will go down, in fact, to the damage from the tower. Couldn't pull the aggro from that. At the same time, Funnick is one last hit away from killing off Bone 7, and he just got it. Bone 7, maybe not. Nice bottle charge, but even without boots, he's still able to run away from Funnick just fast enough.
Wow. I think Kaipi, they always pick to have mid-game heroes. The problem is Na'Vi, they're decimating them so hard early game that the mid-game is going to be so weak on Kaipi's end just because they're not going to have any items. This mag is... He's not going to have a Blink Dagger anytime soon.
No.
Unless he gets like a triple kill, and he's going to die again.
Are they diving him right now? We're going to throw the RP out on Dendi. Dendi had a refraction charge, but he's got to hit himself a haste room with a DD. And then Bone 7 TP's in, and then he gets instantly stunned by Puppy. And then just bail. The Clockwork Goblins are banned at the top lane now. So this is exactly what Funnick likes. Is he even up to his first... Yeah, he's got his first Oblivion staff.
Yep, he's going to be damn for him. And that kill didn't matter. I mean, it was... This... Him actually using the RP is probably as better than a kill, because the next however long RP is on cooldown for the 120 seconds, 2 minutes Na'Vi can do whatever they want. They can put pressure in any map and they don't have to worry about this AoE ulti that can change a team fight. And the mech is going to be useless too. He can't really roam the map without the RP right now.
Mm-hmm.
So he's stuck mid. He's stuck with no HP, no mana. He's buckling, but he's not going to be able to farm anything.
Seeing some rotations now from Na'Vi. They also realize we're at the 7 minute mark, so most of the wards have actually timed out already. In fact, the Radiant only have one ward on the map, and that's down the bottom, and the pings are already coming for the top lane. And Bone 7, creep waves in range of the tower, so nothing's going to stop Na'Vi from diving. This Puppy's already setting up for the stun. And Bone 7, sitting in the middle of the tower, acid spray on him. There goes the stun. Cogs will be wasted. However, it's a double TP coming in. The damage is still enough to kill from Funnick to kill him off, and the secondary TP is cancelled, but Envy... Whoa, 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 whoa! big jump in there, and he almost calculated the kill. But maybe the TP that was cancelled was a Ryze who's having some troubles here in middle lane, because Dendi's going to kill him off. Very, very simple. At the same time, Batrider playing around on the bottom lane to see a TP out from Lina to get back to base safely.
Wow, Ami has so much map control. And it's funny, it's these two moves where they ganked mid and funny killing top. It just, their pressure, the supports on Kaipi, they can't just be static farming bottom anymore with the pulls. They need to go around and match the aggression that Navi's doing, or else the rest of the map is basically 2v4. Because Havos is just staying bottom, and 4 of Navi's heroes are mid and top, and they're just putting pressure.
You do wonder about it, though. Like, Havos, it's free farming bottom lane. This Blink Dagger is going to be coming pretty damn fast for him, too. Even though I don't think, like, what's his CS looking like in that bottom lane? It's 30 for 4. It's not actually as high as I would have expected for Havos. Pylite dies in the top lane. Klinks will take him. Oh, RP blowing. RP's blown on the top lane, and Funnik just jumped invis the second the Pwn7 initiated. They had no reveal whatsoever. So it's another kill for Funnik, and he's got 2 Oblivion Staffs already. What was the timing I say on the Orchid? 13 minutes?
Yeah.
This is gonna be even. This is gonna be like 11. Yeah, 10 or 11. It's. If Denny takes this mid tower, then it's basically his already.
That's scary to play. Like, this Klinks, the threat of this Klinks is going to give them early Roshan also. I know that Empire loved running Klinks TA on Dire. Rest in peace, Empire. Or rest in peace, Goblack.
Do we call it rest in peace, Empire? I still want to know where Goblack's going to end up, man. I want to know where he's going to end up.
Dendi's going to go on. This is Zao.
Yeah, that's too easy. Meld hit. Oh, nice little hit, but then Flame Break. I think he was hoping the Spy Carapace will buy him enough time to TP out from that one, but it's not to be the case.
Yeah, but this Klinks and TA, they can even go right now and just do Roshan by themselves, and can do it within... Oh, Envy's he's gonna be fine. But they can do it within the minute or so, because they have so much damage with the... if the Klinks heats a good creep.
And especially with the DD rune, Oh man. It does really feel like I'm watching Empire. It's the Empire lineup.
It's like Empire, but they're playing better. Like, no offense, Empire usually when they try lane, they didn't move like this. Stuck with their try lane, but Navi, they're just going around roaming the map.
Oh, double TPs again have to come to the top lane, and Kuros is not running out of here. Envy wants to blink up and have a crack, but look at Envy's life. He TPs in when he's this weak, and Funny's just like, okay, Orchid and death. Three hits after the Orchid went off, and the Orchid was mainly just used so that he wouldn't blink himself away to safety. And now Bone7 says, well, okay, Funnik's still here. I know he's still here. They're sitting right next to each other. The only problem is Funnik's low on mana, so Bone7 going to initiate him with the ultimate. Funnik goes invis, and Lightstrike Array also can miss. Dust flies off to the side. At the same time, TA picks off the Nyx on the bottom lane, so it's like a Vorst teaming up with him. Have we even seen a lasso from a Vorst?
No, he doesn't need it. He's like, I have this double damage TA attacking. They're gonna get this tower. And with this tower, Denny's gonna have his blink. And it's gonna be trouble. A blink TA and a Orchid Klinks by 11 minutes. Have you ever seen this? I have never seen this much farm on two core heroes like that.
I've seen a Venus Brutal before. Oh, well done, Enforced. He lost to the Catapult. If he got his timing right, they would have actually had
a blink too.
Yeah, they would have had the 2 blink daggers if he got it. And Dendi, for some reason, says buying it once is not enough. He'll buy it a secondary time.
So they have 2 blink daggers and an Orchid. Mm-hmm. That's basically 3 core heroes having insane farm. You never see that in a game.
Well, not in a game like this. Not when KP's playing as well as they have Puppy, Stud, and Death. Blink, and Melvin. It's just too much. It's really just too much to deal with. This was the kind of thing I was looking for from Na'Vi in-game in their semi-final today that I didn't really see. It's just strong laning, it's good laning as well, winning their lanes. I'm not going to say it's going to come down to, like, great individual play, because for me it just feels like it was just the right... This was a decision game. This is a big decision game from Na'Vi. Like, the decision to rotate, the positioning during that timing was good. But everything else just came down to... decision making, be it to win all 3 lanes, and that's exactly what's happened.
Yep. This is like they see an opening and they're gonna go and okay, no. Their smoke runs up the hill.
Arise also has himself a haste rune.
So they should just go Roshan. Yeah, Denny's going to start the Roshan. They can't do anything about it. Phoenix waiting to eat the centaur.
1 second. There it is.
One oh button. My god, he has a... They don't even need him, Roshan.
he's got a Crystallis. Oh, Envy. Oh, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Yeah, pigs are coming out. And Nyx is like, Envy, what are you doing, man? This is like, get your ass out of there. And someone's got a medallion. It's the Alchemist medallion support.
Look at their damage. The acid spray, Roshan's minus 8.
And Denny now has Negus the Immortal. 1 to 10 in. This is spiraling out of control. And then look into the tier 1 tower now in middle lane. Havorse even building up an urn. 10 kills late, but has himself an urn. And there's Blink down. Last suit, they got Envy. Brain Tap, look at the damage. Then instantly onto the Fiend script. Didn't do it on the AM, however, which means then Nyx is the one they want to focus on. Arise comes in to play around. Nice RP catching two at the back. Still AM going to go down right now. Havorse going to stick in the mix. And Clinks, oh man.
Wow, that Alchemist stun hit 3 people.
Locked them all. It kind of almost felt like an RP watching that one. And that's GG well played. 14-minute GG.
Why, Toby? Why? Where's the epic finale?
It's not there, man!
Why did you rob me of the epic finale?
It's not there! Hey, I'm not robbing you a Jack!
Dude, I wanted to see an epic finale, not a 14-minute stop.
Yeah, that was... But at the same time, though, it kind of gives you, like... Well, I suppose it might actually annoy you a lot, too, because next time Team Liquid faces up against Na'Vi. For me, like, Na'Vi lost a lot of confidence in the scene. Like, I wouldn't have even put them in the top 3 for EU. If I was looking at a ranking. And they haven't been playing for a very, very long time. Like, they had like 2 to 3 weeks where there was basically no official games coming out from them. So there was a long, long period of time where things just... Yeah. They weren't right for Na'Vi. They weren't right at all. And a game like that, it gives you flashbacks to what Na'Vi were.
I feel that was because a lot of... the reason that Na'Vi was losing after the funny pickup... I feel they weren't utilizing Funnik the way he should be. Him as a player, he's this kind of player that he does better with farm and he does better with levels and he does a lot of things on the map. Like, he's clutch. Like, he's a clutch player. He was always like that, and that's where that's how he rose to fame. And this playstyle they have right now, where they have these two kind of... It's kind of an LGDN playstyle, or even an Orange playstyle, Orange X playstyle, where they're having these three core heroes farming in each lane.
Yeah.
And they're picking, like, TA, they're picking... I've seen them pick Weaver, they're picking Nyx, etc. And they're Clinks, and they're roaming around, and they're giving all their core heroes farm and levels, and they're just snowballing their way. And Funnik is a really good player that can snowball like this, and they're giving the tools they need to dominate. And this is a scary Na'Vi.
Yeah,
and
it is.
This is way better than the kind of passive playing that Na'Vi was playing, where Funnik was just offlaning with the Darkseer, and he wasn't doing much early, because there really isn't much to do early, and this is way stronger, because they're doing a lot more on the map.
Yeah, they most definitely are, man. I might even have to change my predictions for this weekend. Of course, guys, that's going to be bringing a close to the Join Dota Masters for today. I hope you've enjoyed the coverage for the Masters over the last 2 days. If you missed any of the matches, head yourself over to youtube.com/joindota, and you'll find all the VODs available there. They are also hyperlinked straight into joindota.com, where you're a place you'll also have to go if you want to compete in the next portion of this. Well, the Masters always went hand-in-hand with the Open, and the Open starts tomorrow. So if you have a Dota 2 team, if you have 5 players, and you want to put them together, be it just friends who want to play in a competition, or be it more than that, then jump yourself over to joindota.com and sign up for the Join Dota Open. There's some nice prize money up for grabs for that one too, and not to mention it's a free-for-all, so everybody can play. And also, there will be more keys going out for 50 lucky players who are playing in the Open tomorrow. You will also get a copy of Bioshock Infinite. Options for you on that one, and make sure you keep your bets coming too. So bets, as well as commenting in that news article over on Join Dota, that is the way the sponsors get happy and they give you more free stuff. So at this point, there's 2 graphics cards and a whole bunch of copies of a really awesome game. What comes next time? Well, with many people who've been involved in it and put up comments, who knows? It's going to keep thanking AMD and all the other guys who get behind all of this. All right, and also, last but not least, follow Liquid Bulba. It's not Bulba's dad. It's a fake Twitter. It's not him. It's not Bulba's dad. You can feel robbed. But yeah, follow Liquid Bulba over on Twitter. And thanks for coming on the broadcast, man.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
It's been beautiful. It's been beautiful. All right, guys. Thanks for watching. We'll see you tomorrow. I'll be back tomorrow casting the open about 18 EST. So I'll see you then. Thanks for watching.